Hi everybody. We're about to get started. We had another vote this past week. It was between two popular meat eaters. It was between Allosaurus and Baryonyx. And I was actually expecting Allosaurus to win because I think Allosaurus is like more widely known. More people know Allosaurus, but Baryonyx won. So we're going to be doing Baryonyx, which is kind of good because since it's like a lesser known dinosaur, it's an opportunity for me to teach people more, right? So here's my toy of Baryonyx. Now this toy isn't, it's a little bit outdated because it's kind of old. It's from when I was little, but it gets the point across. So some things that you need to know about Baryonyx is it was a meat-eating dinosaur. It was a theropod, but it is characterized by having a very long, narrow snout, which is very different from the other meat-eating dinosaur that we did, which was T-Rex. Do you prefer Slike or Safari toys? Definitely Safari. Safari LTD, I think, overall produces better dinosaur toys. Schleich has some good ones. Like I think the Parasaurolophus I use is Schleich, but Safari overall I think is a better company for dinosaur toys. But anyway, this is Safari. This is the Carnegie collection, which was discontinued, but it was owned by Safari. But anyway, so Baryonyx had a long, narrow snout, and T-Rex, which is the other one meat eater that we drew so far, has a much boxier, tall, more robust snout. Okay, so they are different. The teeth were different too. We're going to talk about that soon. Another unique thing, or not unique, but interesting thing about Baryonyx is the front limbs. The hands had three fingers on each hand, and the thumb on each finger had a claw that was much bigger and longer than the other two. They all had claws, and all three claws were sharp and curved, but digit one, and this toy does show it pretty well, was particularly long and robust. And that's how the dinosaur got its genus name, which translates to heavy claw. And there's a couple reasons why this dinosaur might have had claws like that and might have had a long, pointy snout like that. And we'll be talking about that. Another thing to note is the most recent installment of the Jurassic Park franchise, Jurassic World, the second Jurassic World movie, had a Baryonyx in it, although it didn't look much like a real Baryonyx. But that's a weird thing to me because, again, I think I talked about this last time. Jurassic Park has a tendency to like exaggerate the dinosaur designs, but this is another example of them making the dinosaur look less interesting than it did in real life. If you don't know, it's the scene with the lava where they're like in the pipes trying to turn on the power, and this dinosaur comes through the tunnels. That was Baryonyx, or was supposed to be Baryonyx, but it didn't have the very long pointed snout with the big long cone-like teeth sticking out all over the place like it would have in real life. And we're going to draw the real one today. All right, so let's get started. So here's my paper. And here's my pencil. Again, I'm just using a regular old pencil. Nothing, it's not a fancy artist pencil of any kind. This is, I got this from like Staples a long time ago. It's not a big deal. Okay. All right. So I'm gonna start off with the head. Let me move my phone for Instagram a little closer because I think they're getting mostly ceiling here. There we go. That's probably better. Okay, cool. So we're gonna start with the head. So this guy had kind of a different head than what we've seen before. Like I said, it had a very long snout. So I'm going to start with the eye, and don't worry, I'll move this closer to the camera if you can't see with the light. So there's the eye there. There's the snout, or basically a basic outline of the snout. Here's the lower jaw. Okay. And there's the neck. Okay, so that's all I have so far. So there's Instagram. It's very, very rough. Okay, and here's Facebook. So you could see it's just very rough. Kind of almost looks like a bird with a long beak. But we're gonna change that in a little bit. And like I said, with most of my dinosaurs, I like to start with the eye. Eye is a good focal point.
So the eye on Baryonyx is a little bit kind of high, placed up high. And then around like kind of where like the forehead would be, like between the eyes, there was actually like a little crest, kind of looked like a horn. And then the snout goes down. And here's where some people get mixed up or they make a mistake. Baryonyx's snout wasn't that simple. It wasn't just like long and pointy. There was more to it than that. There was some different shapes going on here. So the tip of the snout kind of dipped down, and then it kind of went up to form like a little notch, and then it dipped down again. So you can see how like the top of the snout, there's like a little wavy thing in there. All right, and that's important. That's kind of like a diagnostic characteristic of this dinosaur. Keep in mind, Baryonyx wasn't the only one with a snout like this, by the way. It was a member of a family of dinosaurs that all had snouts like this. It was called the Spinosaurs, named after the first known member, Spinosaurus. Although we didn't know Spinosaurus had a snout like that for a while because they never found the head. And then they found Baryonyx, and then they found a couple other ones, like one called Suchomimus. And then they found part of the head of Spinosaurus, and they all had these big, long, pointy snouts. They superficially look like crocodiles, but they're not crocodiles. And we're going to go in more into that. Let's see. Yeah, there's like 40 people watching. That's cool. Right, so I'm going to draw the rest of the mouth. So it's going to go back here. Here's the corner of the mouth. Here's the bottom, the bottom jaw kind of angles up a little bit at the tip. Here's the base of the jaw. All right. And then I'm going to draw where like the ear would go. The ear would probably be behind the head back here. And here's the top of the head. And now the neck, kind of like our Parasaurolophus, where we did like a big piece of droopy skin. I'm not going to do like a big flappy piece of skin like a dewlap, but almost like a caiman-like snout, someone wants to know. I wouldn't even say that. No, they superficially looked like crocodilians, but they weren't. And the reason, the main difference, is a crocodile or a caiman or an alligator, their heads, okay, if this is like the head of it, were like what we call laterally compressed. So they're kind of like flat. It looks someone took a like a sandwich, okay. And but these guys had like more narrow heads, so it was more narrow from side to side, like wedge shaped. So the only thing it had in common really with crocodilians is the fact that it had a long snout, but that's about it. Every other thing about the snout dimension wise was different. So now we're going to start to do the teeth. Now Baryonyx had really cool teeth. Spinosaurs in general had cool teeth. So here's a tooth from a Spinosaurus, okay, which is in the same family as Baryonyx, so it's similar. And you could see, if you remember, my T-Rex tooth from last time is different. The T-Rex tooth was like long and pretty curved. I'm gonna move the phone again because I don't want to have to keep going back and forth between two different things. So hopefully this is okay. There we go. Okay, so that's better, yeah. So the tooth of a Spinosaur is like a cone. It's straight and long and pointy. Okay, there's a little bit of serration on the sides here. But this isn't a tooth meant for like grabbing and holding on and crushing. This is a tooth meant for grabbing and holding on and just holding on. So, which makes sense considering the fact that these guys are most likely eating a lot of fish. So if you look at animals that eat a lot of fish, today they have tools kind of like this. The one that comes to mind is a crocodilian called a gharial. They have a long, narrow snout, and they have big, long, pointy, interlocking teeth. So when they close their mouth, interlocking means that when the mouth is closed, the teeth kind of crisscross. Okay, so that makes like a good trap when they grab like a wiggly, slippery fish. Okay, whereas T-Rex that had these big, robust, banana-like teeth wasn't like grabbing for fish, it was chomping into big dinosaurs. So it needed to have different tools for what it did. So Baryonyx had teeth kind of like this. So we're going to draw the teeth now. So at the tip, the teeth were long. And then they got really short in this little crook part, and then they got long again. And same thing for the bottom. Tip, they were pretty long, and they were very pointy, were not curved. And they got short again. Now the lower jaw is kind of facing towards us a little bit, so I'm going to do the other side of the lower jaw. Someone asked if Spinosaurids had lips like a lizard or if they had no lips like a crocodile. And the answer to that is I don't know. I wasn't there, and I don't think anybody really has a true answer for that. There's people that have opinions on it, but there's no hard consensus. I do this, I'm going to do this one without it. Because I personally think that the way this animal was designed, it makes more sense for it to not have them, considering the fact that it was going in the water eating fish all the time, but it may have had them. If you remember, I did my Tyrannosaurus with lips. It's kind of different. Right, so there's the other side of the jaw. All right, and then we're going to do the nostril, which was like right about here. So important to note, Baryonyx's nostril was not at the tip of its nose, like all the other dinosaurs we've done so far. Okay, so most dinosaurs have the nostril at the tip here. Baryonyx's nostril was halfway up the snout, which also supports the idea of it being a fish eater. So if you imagine, this dinosaur probably hung out by the water and was dipping the front of its snout in the water. Maybe it had like a strategy, kind of like a heron, where it didn't move for a long time and just kind of sat there in one place and waited for fish to come to it, and then it snapped them up at the last minute. So if it was sitting there with its with the tip of its nose in the water, it would need to breathe. The indentation in the front of the snout is probably helping to grab the fish. So kind of like a little fish trap. So it'd hook the fish with the tip of the jaw and they wouldn't be able to just fall out of the mouth. At least that's what we think. All right, let's start doing the rest of the body. So underneath the throat, I'm going to do kind of like a pouch, almost like a pelican. So it kind of had like a crop for the food it was eating. And now I'm going to start doing the body. This one's going to be kind of angled a little bit towards us, kind of like our T-Rex was. But I'm going to have it in a bit of a different position. It's going to be kind of standing there. Well, the T-Rex was, I think, walking or running. Okay, so there's my basic outline of the body. Okay, it's very rough. It's just shapes right now. It's a circle for the middle, and just lines for the legs and the tail. Okay, and I'm going to flesh those out as we go along. So let's get to the chest. Now, unlike T-Rex, Baryonyx didn't have short arms. Its arms were relatively long, so it probably used them for different things. Now, again, and I think I mentioned this with some of the other dinosaurs that we've done. I'm not falling into the trap of making the arms really skinny. Some people keep making their little tiny skinny popsicle stick arms for their dinosaurs, and that's not really accurate to what they would have been like. They would have had a little bit more beef on them. So I'm making sure my arms are nice and relatively thick, and then I'm going to start doing the first digit, and watch how big I make this claw here. Okay, so that's the first claw, and it's proportionally huge. Okay, in fact, I could probably even afford to make that bigger. It's kind of hard to see all the proportions when I'm angled. Like, you gotta remember, guys, I'm angled at a really weird position. Like, I am not, this is not optimal drawing pose for me. I'm kind of like off to the side drawing up and down for you guys. So sometimes I lose track of what I'm doing. There we go. Okay, so there it is. Okay, that's better. So that's even bigger. All right, that's the first digit. The second finger is longer, but the claw is shorter. And the third digit's claw is even shorter than that. Okay, so there's our hand. And there's ideas of what these claws were for. They were most likely to help get food. Someone said hooking fish like a bear hunting salmon. Yeah, probably. So if the jaws didn't get them, they probably would use the claws to help hook them out. They also could have helped to manipulate the food. So once they grabbed it with the mouth, the claws could kind of come in and make sure the fish didn't get away. Here's the other arm I'm going to do behind it. So there's going to be some overlap. So you're not going to see the whole thing. There we go. So there's the other hand. Those are some nasty, wicked claws. And now we can move on to the belly. So the belly kind of comes down like that. There would be a bone, a hip bone that comes down here called the pubis. Here's the thigh. Here's the knee I'm sketching here. Here's the leg. Here's the ankle. Remember, dinosaurs walked on their toes. So that's the ankle there. And now here's the other leg. The other ankle and the other foot. I'm not drawing the feet just yet. And here's the top of our tail. And the bottom of our tail. And remember, the base of most dinosaur tails was very thick. Okay, so don't skimp. Don't make your tail too skinny. Okay, the base of these tails were quite thick. Let me think. The back, I'm going to add a little bit more to. So even though Baryonyx was not exactly like Spinosaurus, it still had a little bit of a ridge on its back. A slight one, not a lot. Kind of almost like our Parasaurolophus, coincidentally. If you remember that. There we go. Okay. Looking good. I'm actually going to go back and make the crest on the nose a little bit bigger too. Because in life, it might have been even bigger. Because there could have been some keratin on the outside of that. It might have been a cool shape too. There we go. That's better. Okay. So there's that. There's our Baryonyx. So that's kind of like the basic line. Now, why didn't I draw the feet yet? I'll tell you why. Because I decided, and maybe you can draw the feet on yours if you want to, but I decided that the environment is going to be like a watery environment. So maybe our Baryonyx is hunting right now. So it's wading out into the water. So I'm actually going to make it so it's kind of like foot deep in some water. And I'm going to do that by kind of just cutting off the feet and drawing some like circle, like some flat circles around it, okay? Looks like it's in the water. And then we're gonna draw the water around it. But this looks like there's like ripples in the water and the Baryonyx is maybe about to get some fish. Or maybe it already has, it just swallowed them already. I don't know if anybody knew this, but even though we have the body parts that suggest it was a fish eater, we actually have proof that Baryonyx was eating a fish in the form of fish scales, fossilized fish scales. I'm just erasing some of the messy lines there, in its stomach. Okay, so we know for a fact Baryonyx was a fish eater because it was found with fish inside of it. Okay, in addition to that, we know that Baryonyx didn't only eat fish. It ate other things too. We found bones from a different dinosaur also, or chunks of bone fragments from a different dinosaur inside of Baryonyx's stomach cavity. That dinosaur was a kind of iguanodon, or it wasn't iguanodon itself. It was in the iguanodon family. So if you might know iguanodon. It's a plant-eating dinosaur with a thumb spike. Okay. Well, there was a species of dinosaur that was in the same family as Iguanodon called Mantellosaurs that would have lived the same time and place as Baryonyx. And we have evidence that Baryonyx was eating one of these plant-eating dinosaurs. Now, was Baryonyx hunting that dinosaur? We don't know. Maybe it scavenged it. Maybe they really didn't hunt other dinosaurs, but they would scavenge them if they had the opportunity. I don't know. Maybe it was hunting it. But we know that it wasn't only eating fish. It did eat fish, but it ate other stuff too. Okay. So there's our Baryonyx. Now we're going to go in with the shading. Okay. So I'm going to start with the head again. I'm going to start inside the mouth because that's probably the darkest thing on this dinosaur. And as I get further out of the mouth, just like our T-Rex, the shading is going to get lighter. I'm going to do the underside of this crest, the tip of the nose, the bottom of the jaws, the bottom of the throat, some wrinkles here, all the skin bunching up when it moves its head around. And I'm going to go to the arm. I'm going to shade in this arm here. This arm is on the opposite side, so the shadow from the chest is on this arm. And now I'm going to do the claws. Okay. Underneath the chest, there's going to be, of course, a big shadow. On the other side of any animal, there's always going to be a pretty big shadow. Underside of the neck. Now we're going to shade this big hook-like claw. Underside of the arm. The back leg. Nice big shadow there. Ankle. There we go. I'm pressing down pretty hard with my pencil right now. There we go. The knee is going to make a shadow on the leg there, and then the leg is going to make a shadow on the foot. See how I just added those two shadows? So now it went from looking like a flat thing to something that is actually bent. The knee looks like it's bent away from us, and the foot looks like it's bent towards us, which is what I want to do. So it's amazing how just a little couple of scribble lines can make something look so much better. Art isn't really hard. It just takes a lot of practice. No one just picks up a pencil and is instantly a fantastic artist. There's some people who are just have a knack for it more than others.